everyone. Welcome back for week two of On Bach's Time, His Life in Music. Last class, we looked at Bach's early years and studies in the cities of Eisenach, Ohrdruf, Lüneburg, Arnstadt, and Weimar. Today, we'll discuss Johann Sebastian Bach's life in music in the next city he lived, Cöthen. This Cöthen period spans from 1717 to 1723, and Bach from age 32 to 37. During this time, Bach served as Kapellmeister and director of chamber music at the court of Prince Leopold in Cöthen, where he composed the majority of the secular and instrumental music. He was able to devote his attention more particularly to instrumental composition for solo instruments, for solo groups, and for the small court orchestra. Among these works are at least two of four suites for orchestra, three sonatas and three partitas for unaccompanied violin, the six suites for unaccompanied cello, the Brandenburg concertos, various solo concertos, cantatas, and the first book of the Well-Tempered Clavier. There are also sonatas for violin and harpsichord, and for viola da gamba and harpsichord, sometimes appropriated these days by violists or cellists. The opening music to our class was the ever serene Air on the G String from his third orchestral suite. 3 years prior to moving to Cöthen, while still living in Weimar, Bach expanded his focus to include more composition and to refine his technical skills. He also wouldn't limit himself to keyboard genres and performance. The earliest writings on Bach's early compositional activities can be found in a biography dating back to 1802 by a German musicologist by the name of Johann Nicolas Forkel. Forkel was able to correspond with Bach's sons Carl Philipp Emanuel, or CPE for short, and Wilhelm Friedemann. In discussing Bach's beginnings in the biography, Forkel plainly states, Bach's first attempts at composition were, like all attempts, defective. Forkel also stresses that Bach was without a guide. This corroborates Bach's son's writings in the obituary, which states that he was largely self-taught as a composer. According to Bach's sons, Bach felt there must be order, connection, and proportion in the thoughts, and that to attain such objectives, some kind of guide was necessary. In the realm of the concerto genre, Bach found a guide in the concertos for violin by Italian composer Antonio Vivaldi, which had just been published. Concertos, as a refresher, is a large-scale musical work for a soloist and or more instruments accompanied by an orchestra. Bach so often heard Vivaldi's concertos praised and admired that he conceived the happy idea of arranging them all for keyboard. In these works, he studied the chain of events or chain of musical ideas, how the ideas related, the variations of the modulations, and other particulars of the form and style. Bach delved into the modern Italian concerto style of Vivaldi and his contemporaries, and this led him to innovative structural designs. Bach himself wrote that Vivaldi's work taught him how to think musically. According to Bach's biographer, Forkel, Vivaldi's music represented these three things: Ordnung, Zusammenhang, and Verhältnis, or order, coherence, proportion. Except these German terms do not translate so simply. Rather, they encompass more: order, organization, coherence, connection, continuity, and proportion, correlation. Forkel proposes that this also is the definition, Bach's definition of musical thinking. To me, it sounds very logical and functional. Now back to Vivaldi. Born in Venice in 1678, and so 7 years older than Bach, Antonio Vivaldi was an incredible violin virtuoso, a prolific composer, an opera impresario, and all-around musical entrepreneur. He was creative and forward-thinking in his violin playing and wanted to take advantage of new trends in the music industry. He brought a clear structure and new dramatic power to the concerto form. Trademarks in his concerto style include three-movement form in a fast, slow-fast design, and an intense concentration of rhythmic figures, depth and singing quality in the slow movements, which are a crossover from his vocal writing, and the imitation of the trumpet sound, for trumpet playing was an integral part of life in Baroque Italy. In short, Vivaldi's concerto style is quite historically significant. His innovations would permeate instrumental and vocal genres as well, and essentially influence the course of 18th century music. Let's listen to Vivaldi. Let's listen to the trumpets played by the violins. Here is Vivaldi's Violin Concerto No. 12 in E major from the collection L'Estro Armonico. Vivaldi conceptualized the concerto, including tackling any musical problems and seeing new possibilities, and how Vivaldi was an architect and exponent of the new method. Bach must have marveled at this demonstration and evidence of the concerto genre as the perfect vehicle for musical thinking. Bach's encounters with the Italian concerto idiom are notable, for it drove a distinctive shaping of his own personal style, which integrates Italian elements with his complex, elegant counterpoint, thus creating harmonic depth and finesse and more expressive impact. In the Cöthen years, or perhaps I could say the concerto years, we have only violin concertos by Bach, which survive in their original form. The others exist now only in transcriptions for harpsichord. The original works we do have are the concerto in A minor and E major, and the double concerto in D minor for two violins. Let's listen to the double concerto now, here played by Arabella Steinbacher and Akiko Suonai. Great concerto. By the time Bach moved to Cöthen in 1717, he was aware of his growing reputation. And in that year, there was the first printed reference to Bach that his music must make one esteem the man highly. Shortly before the move to Cöthen, there was a popular anecdote involving him and another popular keyboard virtuoso that was circulating around Germany. The event was to be a contest held at the electoral court in Dresden, a thrilling match of two virtuosos, the French harpsichordist Louis Marchand versus Johann Sebastian Bach. Bach was invited from Weimar by the concertmaster in Dresden to engage in this contest for superiority. Bach and Marchand were in agreement and ready to execute ex tempore, to improvise on the spot, any musical task the other set for him. Bach appeared at the appointed time and scene, waiting until the public was stunned and disappointed to hear news that Monsieur Marchand had left very early that morning, and the reason is not known. So let's musically meet the would-be opponent of Bach, Louis Marchand. Here is his minuet from the harpsichord suite in D minor, performed on harpsichord by David Moroni. It's got a lot of verve. Incidentally, Bach specifically knew this minuet as it was included in his older brother Johann Christoph, the brother in Ordruf's anthology called the Müller Manuscript. It's possible that for the Dresden contest on Bach's end, he may have brought out the kind of bravura playing we hear in his chromatic fantasy in Fugue. And I think I can play the opening of that. To Weimar from Dresden, Bach was embroiled in an incident. Apparently, he made a demand from the Dukes, perhaps for an earlier dismissal from his post, in anticipation of his work waiting in Cöthen. And this demand enraged one of the Dukes, and he was, egad, placed in jail. He was freed 4 weeks later, fortunately, and was discharged. And then off to Cöthen, he and his family went. How may have Bach occupied himself while in prison for 4 weeks? It's possible he wrote much of his Well-Tempered Clavier, Part 1, the first volume of 24 preludes and fugues in every major and minor tonality there. The son of a student of Bach's, named Ernst Ludwig Gerber, reported how the jail was a place where ennui, boredom, and the absence of any kind of musical instrument forced him, Bach, to resort to this pastime. Fugues, eh? So a new chapter as Kapellmeister to the Prince of Anhalt-Cöthen in the city of Cöthen began for Bach's family, which at this time had grown to six. The oldest daughter, Katharina Dorothea, was now 9, and the three boys, Wilhelm Friedemann, CPE, and Johann Gottfried Bernhard, were 7, 3, and 2 respectively. Before they settled into Cöthen, Bach spent a few days in Leipzig, a city which was a stark contrast to Cöthen. Leipzig was a vibrant, bustling metropolis with all of its courtly splendor, wealth, population of over 30,000, and it was home to the most prestigious university in Germany. On the other hand, Cöthen was a tenth of the size and not as musically vibrant. The silver lining, however, was that Bach's new patron in Cöthen was the Prince Leopold, who loved music. He was a connoisseur of music and showed a keen interest as well in architecture and literature. Just before turning 16, the prince traveled Europe and enjoyed attending the operas in Venice and The Hague. He also played violin, harpsichord, and the viola da gamba. In addition to his patron's support of the music and the arts and the high priority assigned to Bach's position, Bach was also pleased with the caliber of the elite professional musicians in the Kapelle to work with. The Kapelle included a core group recruited from Berlin, hired by Leopold's mother back in 1713, and that far exceeded that of the Weimar ensemble. In Kirchen, the court Kapelle had about 16 members, and they were mostly instrumentalists. In size and function, it differed than the Weimar Kapelle. Where in Weimar, the palace church services played an important role, sacred music took a secondary position at the Cöthen court. Bach formed close ties with some of these colleagues, becoming godfather to the three musicians' children. While there doesn't exist specific information on what repertoire was programmed, we know the Kapelle rehearsed and gave courtly performances, likely at least weekly. Music, musical soirees, and entertainment were integral to courtly life at Cöthen. We can be sure that the instrumental works dated to this period and that were performed at court functions included the Brandenburg concertos, French suites, the Well-Tempered Clavier, the sonatas and partitas for solo violin, and the suites for solo cello. There were 2 days at the court filled with an exceptional amount of music, including vocal soloists. These were Prince Leopold's birthday and New Year's Day. Some of the music written for these occasions was lost or incomplete, but Bach's music for the cantatas, BWV 134 and 173, that were performed still exist. Looking at only the vocal works Bach composed for these two important dates and between the years 1718 and 1723, the survival rate is still devastating, with only a 9 out of expected 22 works. With not much tangible evidence of the original scores, how do we explain the losses? Some manuscript scores kept in the library of the court capel vanished without a trace. Also, in Bach's reworking of cantatas, he sometimes reworked a secular cantata into the sacred repertoire. And thirdly, some of Bach's heirs may have considered secular scores less interesting or useful than the sacred. While our impression is sketchy of Bach's vocal compositional output in Cöthen, some key features stand out. In all the secular works, the vocal parts are for solo singers, often just two, and many have elaborate duos and solos that are challenging on technical and artistic levels. The composition of the cantata Amore Traditore for solo bass and concertato harpsichord may have coincided with a rare situation occurring towards the end of Bach's first year in Cöthen. The celebrated virtuoso bass singer Johann Gottfried arrived for an extended stay at court. Concertato harpsichord caught my eye and my ear, haha. So let's have a listen a little to an aria from this work.
Amore traditore, tu non m'inganni più. Amore traditore, tu non m'inganni più.
We might say Bach was fairly content with his musical situation in Cöthen. Within the capel were some of the finest musicians he could have hoped to work with. Secondly, he had free time to pursue his own interests. And third, his patron was very supportive. Later, Bach wrote in a letter dated 1730, there in Cöthen, I had a gracious prince who both loved and knew music. And in his service, I intended to spend the rest of my life. Bach, however, noticed after the prince's marriage to Princess Federica Henrietta, that she did not share her husband's love of music. Bach saw his role in court decline in importance, which may have encouraged him to seek employment elsewhere. Cöthen was located in a mostly rural area and was even sometimes mockingly dubbed Cow Cöthen. It was much more remote than Bach's previous cities of Arnstadt, Mulhausen, and Weimar. And so he traveled more in the 5-year period that he lived in Cöthen than in any other of his life. His professional travels, although somewhat geographically confined, expanded his cultural, social, and musical experience. One highlight of these travels included a trip to Berlin to purchase a harpsichord. And this was in the year 1719. In early 1719, Bach went to Berlin to acquire a new state-of-the-art harpsichord for the princely court in Cöthen. Since the harpsichord arrived March 14th in Cöthen, it's possible Bach had traveled to Berlin earlier to commission the instrument. The dates between his recorded advance from the court treasury to purchase the harpsichord and its arrival in Cöthen suggest that Bach possibly stayed in Berlin for a week or more, affording him time to make contacts and to perform at the Prussian court. Here, he likely met the Margrave Christian Ludwig of Brandenburg, brother of the deceased king and the youngest son of the Grand Elector Friedrich Wilhelm of Prussia. Just by the way, in modern times, a margrave ranks immediately below a duke and above a counter earl. It was for this Margrave Christian Ludwig for whom Bach assembled the Brandenburg concertos, the six concerts avec plusieurs instruments, six concertos for many instruments. We learn from the preface of the dedication score of 1721 that he played for the Margrave 2 years earlier, so possibly, very likely in Berlin. This preface reads, "As I had a couple of years ago the pleasure of appearing before Your Royal Highness, and as I noticed then that Your Highness took some pleasure in the small talents that heaven has given me for music, Your Highness deigned to honor me with the command to send Your Highness some pieces of my composition. I have then, in accordance with Your Highness's most gracious orders, taken the liberty of rendering my most humble duty to Your Royal Highness with the present concertos, which I have adapted to several instruments." The Brandenburg concertos celebrate virtuosic performance and feature six concertos with unprecedented configurations of soloists. Bach is daring in his combinations of instruments and masterful in the thematic and motivic treatment and in his imitative polyphony. The fifth concerto, which presents violin, flute, and harpsichord as soloists, and with quite a prominent keyboard part, might be my favorite. It was the first time in history of the concerto that a solo keyboard instrument was so distinctly highlighted. The first movement includes a considerable cadenza of 64 measures long for harpsichord. It's in fact been suggested that the writing also in the fifth concerto in an earlier version or an earlier life may have been used or interpolated during his expected contest with Louis Marchand. Now, given the limited input of the violin and flute solo parts, just as compared to that of the harpsichord, this concerto can be seen as a harpsichord concerto. And moreover, the first harpsichord or keyboard concerto ever written. So let's listen to the opening of this fantastic concerto. I had the great enjoyment of performing this wonderful concerto and the second and third concerto with the Saskatoon Symphony just a couple short weeks ago. And I do believe the concert may still be available on the digital concert stream or there's more information online, I'm sure. That's the wonderful opening of the concerto. And maybe we can listen to a bit of the cadenza as well. Not all 64 measures, but I'll play a little bit with a lead-in. Just jump ahead to a little bit later to more of the improvisatory cadenza-like figure. Mm-hmm. on and builds up in a lot of excitement. And then the orchestra rejoins. It's just a lot of fun to play. So let's return to Bach's travels. While personally and professionally benefiting Bach with his acquisition of a new harpsichord, of new contacts, and his celebrated performances, this also mutually benefited the prince to have an extraordinary virtuoso like Bach shed glory on his court. There are two occasions during Bach's Cöthen period in which the prince was able to showcase his wonderful musicians from his Kapelle in Karlsbad. Karlsbad, which was about 130 miles south of Cöthen. Since 21 years of age, Prince Leopold's health was fragile, and his physician advised him to take the waters at the fashionable resort spa in Karlsbad. The saliferous, or very salty, medicinal springs were discovered in the 14th century by Emperor Karl IV. And by 1711, an elegant health holiday resort had emerged. This soon became a trendy spot for the upper echelons of European aristocracy, where Leopold, Prince Leopold, was able to present the exceptional musicians of court before a distinguished audience. And hey, maybe help put his tiny principality on the map. Besides drinking the waters, hunting, and dining, the guests also, of course, enjoyed entertainment provided by some of the noble patrons. Many of these noblemen, including two wealthy and influential arts patrons, helped create and institute a seasonal atmosphere of what may in fact be one of the earliest annual summer music festivals. Upon returning to Cöthen from his second trip to Karlsbad, sadly, Bach was met with the most tragic event of his life. He returned to the sudden and shocking loss of his wife, Maria Barbara, his wife of 12 and a half years and the mother of their four children, ranging in age 5 to 11. She was already buried by the time he returned, and the cause of her death is not known. I did not find a record on her musical activities, but likely she was musical as her father was an organist. Later in the following year, 1721, Bach was permitted to make a major new appointment to the Kapelle ensemble. That summer, the young soprano singer, Anna Magdalena Wilk, appeared on the scene in Cöthen as princely singer and a high-ranked court musician. Anna Magdalena would be both the first full-time female member of the Kapelle, and she was also the highest-earning court musician after the Kapellmeister. It's possible from the beginning of their appointment that they were already acquainted. She may have auditioned for him at the court or at another occasion at a nearby neighboring court. Considering the interrelationships among musicians and their families, her father and her three brother-in-laws were trumpeters. It would have been very unusual for Bach to have not encountered her extended family of musicians. Anna Magdalena was beginning a promising career as a singer, and after she and Bach married, she did continue to sing in the Kapelle until their eventual move to Leipzig. They married on December 3rd, 1721, and in opulent style. It is recorded that they had a major shipment of Rhine wine for the occasion. The union likely brought an uplifting change for Bach and his four children. Sometime in 1722, not long after their wedding, Anna Magdalena began an album in which Johann Sebastian entered keyboard compositions for her to play and improve her skin, or for him to play to entertain her. She wrote the title page, Clavier Buchlein for Anna Magdalena Bach, the year 1722, and some headings, but the musical entries are all in Bach's handwriting. They include five short, yet very refined suites for harpsichord, which would eventually become the set of six French suites. And I've included an interesting interview about the fifth suite with a performance by pianist Murray Pariah on the playlist. Shifting to another topic, it's quite curious that Bach and his compatriot, German Friedrich Handel, apparently never met. Somehow, these two giants of Baroque classical music were born the same year in 1685 and only approximately 80 miles apart, had it met. Bach was in Thuringia and Handel in nearby Saxony at the time of their birth. And Bach was looking forward to meeting the great Handel. Once he set out to meet him, only to find him already gone upon his arrival. And he also extended an invitation to his home, which Handel replied with regrets. It's a little odd, maybe, that Handel just could not have been as curious to meet Bach, who we remember in his youth traveled 250 miles by foot to hear Dietrich Buxtehude, the famous organist in Lübeck. In 1722, following the death of Johann Kuhnau, the cantor at St. Thomas's Church and music director in Leipzig, Bach made a serious bid for that position. Despite his good terms with Prince Leopold, his situation there became a little less than ideal. There was an internal conflict between the prince's family. The prince's health problems played a factor. There was a religious feud between the Lutheran minority and Calvinist majority. There was a serious situation in which there was a serious lack of space and shortage of teachers. Ostensibly 117 children were lumped into a class. And Bach was thinking of his children, of course, at this time. And further, the theological, educational, and moral qualifications of a school inspector were quite in question. So all these reasons, times haven't changed, would fuel his intentions to seek his fortune elsewhere. And as Bach would write in a letter later in 1730 to his friend, George Erdmann, with the job of cantor at St. Thomas's and music director in Leipzig opening up, without great delay, the Leipzig council elected George Philipp Telemann to the post. Telemann had begun his musical career in Leipzig, where as a law student, he founded a collegium musicum and had served as organist and music director for a brief time. However, he declined the offer of a St. Thomas cantorship as his financial situation, coincidentally, improved in Hamburg where he worked. Since Telemann had auditioned in Leipzig for the position, he would have traveled twice through Cöthen. It's quite possible that he may have stopped as well to visit his friend, his good friend Bach, and his godson, CPE, Carl Philipp Emanuel. Therefore, Bach may have learned about Telemann's negotiations, and hey, who knows, maybe Telemann gave Bach the little encouragement to throw his hat into the ring for the job in Leipzig. Bach's name did come up for the second round and evaluation of candidates, and the Leipzig Council chose him, as well as another court Kapellmeister, Christoph Graupner, as the favorites. Graupner ranked ahead for, however, two reasons. Like Telemann, he was a familiar figure and law student in Leipzig. He was an alumnus of the St. Thomas School and had been a pupil of the former cantor. And it's true that Bach was the only candidate without a university degree. And actually, all the predecessors of the St. Thomas cantorate since the 16th century and all the successors that would eventually follow Bach well into the 19th century were all university trained. Basically, 2 days before Graupner's audition, the city council offered him, Graupner, the job. And in the end, he didn't have the necessary dismissal from his current court, and the council, well, had to settle on Bach. By letter, Prince Leopold granted Bach a gracious dismissal, offering him the highest recommendations for service elsewhere. And soon after, the entire Leipzig City Council moved to proceed with Bach's appointment, voting unanimously. Bach maintained contact with Prince Leopold and would return occasionally to Kirchen for performances. A visit with Anna Magdalena was dated in 1725 and documented how the Leipzig cantor Bach and his wife gave a number of performances. And 5 years later, Bach would return again to pay his beloved former patron, his final honors. He composed and performed along with Anna Magdalena and his son, Wilhelm Friedemann, the music for the state funeral. The two compositions, regrettably, have not survived. However, we know that this lost music borrowed 7 arias and 2 choruses from the St. Matthew Passion by Bach. Bach paid homage to the prince with some of his best music. And we will listen to this masterpiece in another class. Let's return to the instrumental music and the solo unaccompanied music in particular of the Cöthen period. Bach's compositional goals in this domain again show his propensity to venture on untrodden musical paths. In both the unaccompanied suites for violin and cello, Bach raised and redefined the technical performance standards and while exploiting their idiomatic qualities of the instruments. Both sets of solo pieces illuminate his ability to create a counterpoint with sophisticated harmonic design and distinctive rhythms without an accompanying bass part in play. Their free improvisatory choir quality, the sheer flair in the rhythm and character of the suite dances lends them to comparison with the French suites for piano dated 1722. Let's look and listen at 2 related works, the 4-part fugue in G minor for solo violin by Bach and its transcription for organ, a fugue in D minor. We can behold the versatility of Bach's musical language and his imagination here, how he takes music originally designed for 4 strings and translates it for manuals and pedals of an organ. Let's listen first to the original for violin. This is Isabella Faust playing the 4-part fugue in G minor for solo violin from Sonata No. 1. Amazing. Now let's compare with the organ fugue in D minor. This is from the Prelude Fugue in D minor, BWV 539. And this is played by Smits from the Netherlands Bach Society. Both versions quite compelling, but you might have a favorite. So often I listen to Bach and love the counterpoint and the sense of athleticism, sometimes in the peaks and valleys of the phrases. And I often think of a dance. And this ties into our next excerpt. For many of Bach's contemporaries, dance reflected social order. For Bach, dance may connote a more mystic level of expression. For instance, the final choruses of his St. John and St. Matthew Passions are evocative of a vast and transcendent saraband. A saraband would mean a slow, stately Spanish dance in triple time. Let's listen to part of this final chorus from Bach's St. Matthew's Passion. music. And you may have heard in a lilting triple time meter. The dance style became essential for Bach when he moved from Weimar in 1717 to the more secular position, as mentioned earlier, in Cöthen. Composition of the three sonatas and three partitas for solo violin were completed by 1720, and the six suites for solo cello likely sometime earlier. All six cello suites follow the same format: a prelude followed by an allemande, a courante, a sarabande, a pair of modish gallant dances such as minuets, bourrées, and gavottes, and a gigue to conclude. This was a fairly conventional sequence of dance movements in Baroque instrumental music and followed the models of French harpsichordists and lutenists. The third cello suite in C major by Bach is said to be the most sonically sensuous of the set. The standard cello tuning, in which open strings sound C, G, D, A. So these would be the open strings. Make drones and the double stops being the playing on two strings simultaneously, such as relatively easy in the key of C major. Bach fills this acoustic opportunity with warm, spacious, and variously rhythmic music. The phrases are based on scales, scale fragments, and on broken chords, which supply the harmony. The grand prelude to the suite opens with a descending scale, kind of an iconic descending scale. And then that broken chord you heard at the end of it. From then on, we hear the shifting patterns emerging from a steady stream of 16th notes. And then the prelude will close with resonant four-note chords. And these creating a full reverberating sound and rhetorical impact. The rhythmic play of cross-accented patterns continues in the ensuing dance movements. The allemande is stately and active. The courante is elegant, nimble, and also introspective to my ear. And as with all of the cello suites, the sarabande is the heart of the suite. The bourrées are rustic and hearty, and an ebullient gigue wraps up this suite. Let's listen to the prelude of this suite, performed by my brother, Alexander Mitzik. Listen to more. It's such an elegant prelude and wonderfully played. To summarize the Cöthen period, we see this was a nourishing atmosphere for Bach. I think the plus of having an encouraging and music-loving patron allowed him to step outside of the conventional framework. And Bach chose to expand on the framework really wherever possible. And this sets him apart from Handel and Telemann, who of course contributed vastly and wonderfully to the repertoire. Bach systemized new techniques, methods, and indefatigably navigated all 24 keys in the well-tempered clavier. Countless genres, he expanded on the genre and form, and he integrate in an abundance of styles. He certainly did not want to stop challenging himself. Before concluding today's class, I'd like to mention Bach's music that's in outer space. In 1977, the space missions Voyager 1 and 2 were sent out to explore the galaxy and carried a recording with musical selections that were intended as an introduction to earthly culture in the off chance the spaceship should be, that the spaceship, the Voyager 1 and 2, were encountered by intelligent life forms. Some Western classical music was included, and Bach was in fact the best represented composer. I never realized that there were actually three separate tracks of Bach on this recording. And I was reading, this wasn't actually enough for one of the enthusiastic scientists who famously encouraged them to simply send Bach, all of Bach, so all of it streamed out into space over and over again. And so the three works are Bach's Brandenburg Concerto No. 2, the first movement played by the Munich Bach Orchestra, conducted by Carl Richter, the Prelude and Fugue from Book 2, The Well-Tempered Clavier, number 1 in C major, played by Glenn Gould, and that's maybe really all you need to impress some aliens, and the Gavotte and Rondo from Partita number 3 in E major, played by the violinist Arthur Grumont. And I couldn't help notice this even sampling from across of Bach's periods. The Brandenburg concertos were likely written in Weimar, the violin partita written in Cöthen, and the second book of Preludes and Fugues was written in during his Leipzig years. So I found that interesting. Not sure if it was a coincidence. And I think we will wrap up the content portion of our class there and open the floor to questions now. And I guess, and actually before we move, before I answer any questions, I will answer one from the previous week because there I was wanting clearer dates or information about the beginnings of harpsichords, organs, and the piano. And the earliest known reference to a harpsichord dates from 1397 in Italy. And the organ is far older. In fact, it dates from the late Hellenistic period, which is 285-222 BC. And this was the water organ. I did include a little clip on the playlist about very early water organs. And the pipe organ has existed in its current form since the 14th century, though similar designs were already appearing from the 4th century AD. And as for the piano, there are other keyboards, many other keyboard designs, instruments besides these, but then the notable keyboard builder and inventor Bartolomeo Cristofori is credited with the invention of the piano. And he also built harpsichords and other keyboard instruments, but the piano built by him in the 1720s boasted most of the features of the modern piano. However, it was of light construction and it lacked a metal frame, so it did not really was able to produce such an especially loud tone that we associate with a much more modern current grand piano. And anyhow, now I will look to see if there are any questions in the Q&A. Anyone has thought of any questions? I have a question for myself. I'm wondering, as Anna Magdaleno was a singer, if she also played the keyboard. It was very common for women back then to own a keyboard, often a keyboard in their own room, and they would play. So I wonder if she also played harpsichord or another keyboard instrument as well. I have more reading ahead of me, so I might find out and update you. Oh, thank you, Bruce. Oh, I have a couple of questions here and I'll read them out loud. Did Bach play in many competitions with other musicians? I don't believe Bach played in any other competitions with other musicians, but there were a few other occurrences, just like this contest between Bach and Marchand, that did occur with some of the celebrity composers. I can't remember which ones at the moment, but it was a fairly common practice, sort of a public musical duel of sorts. And then here's a question. Was it quite common then for women to be musicians in courts and otherwise? I'm not sure how common it was for women to be musicians in court, but extremely common for women to be musicians at home. I did read a story about Bach, I believe it was perhaps in his Weimar years, where women were not allowed in the choir loft. And I think he was reprimanded at some point for allowing a woman to be, to sing as part of in the choir loft. But it was very common for women to be really great keyboard players in this time. And I might talk a little bit more about that in another class, as I'm reading a very interesting book right now that highlights or that focuses on women in Bach's time. So, thank you for your questions. And there's another here. Were the violin cello solo works popular in Bach's lifetime? And I imagine they were certainly played, and we know they were played in the court in Cöthen. And I'm guessing they have gained in popularity also since the Bach revival, but they're certainly very popular these days. And well known, often Bach is a test piece for musicians going to competitions or in auditions for orchestras, for international competitions. And it's music that's really been suitable for an intimate chamber music setting, as well as into the larger concert hall. I do think Bach's music did come overall much more popular and appreciated with every century. I think in his time, his music was regarded a bit on the complex and intellectual side. And so maybe the people got more used to to his language and the very intricate complexities of it, which they now love. I love. I think it would have been great if Bach wrote a double harpsichord concerto, but that's a question I might ask him, have asked him. Well, if there aren't any more questions, I think we might wrap up week two, and I will look forward to week three next week. Thank you everyone for joining me, and until then, thank you.